Good evening, everyone. My name is Sumitra. I'm working as assistant professor in the Department of Biotechnology, Chaitanya Bharati Institute of Technology, Hyderabad. I would like to introduce the speaker for today's session, Dr. Satish Babu Garu, who is the head, Department of Biotechnology, NIT Warangal. Sir, it's a great privilege for me to introduce you, as I was one of your students at Bojreddy Engineering College. Firstly, thank you for accepting our invitation and being a part of this webinar come FDP series, sir. Thank you very much. Sir's research interests include system biology, modeling, simulation and optimization of bioprocesses, bioinformatics and nanobiotechnology. Dr. Satish Babu sir's ongoing projects are bioremediation studies of automobile effluent water by conventional and system biology approach. The next one being biological nitrification and denitrification of aquatic wastewater, and this is funded by MHRD. The next one is process development for cellulose acetate based nanoporous membranes for arsenic and fluoride removal from groundwater to make potable water. And this particular project is funded by CSIR. The next one is production and purification of L-asparaginase from Bacillus stratospericus. Well, sir has a commendable professional experience, which includes working as assistant professor in BRECW from August 2000 to June 2006. And since June 2006, sir has been working as associate professor at MIC College of Technology till March 2012, and since then he's been working as associate professor at NIT Warangal till date. Sir has over about 30 publications and a book chapter, and sir also has a patent to his credit which was published on 9th of February 2015. And this patent was on continuous solution phase production of beta peptide using spiral copper channel microreactor. Sir has many awards to his credit and professional affiliations. The first one being, he is an associate member in IICHE, member Indian Society of Technical Education. Sir has received Best Paper Award in National Conference at JNTU Anantapur in the year 2004. He's elected as Associate Fellow of Telangana Academy of Sciences for the year 16-17. Sir, thank you very much for accepting our invitation, and I congratulate you on being elected as the outstanding faculty in the discipline of Bioprocess Engineering by Venus International Society in the year 2016. Now, I kindly request you to continue with the lecture, sir. Thank you.
Good afternoon to everyone. I'm going to give you a presentation on modeling, simulation, and optimization of bioprocess. These are the contents: introduction, modeling principles and fundamentals of modeling, modeling approaches, neural network modeling, simulation using Berkeley Moderna program. So these are the contents. So initially, if you think about the model, so first question is, so what is a model? So the model is nothing but it's a three-dimensional representation of a person or a thing or a proposed structure, typically on a smaller scale than the original one. So if you look at the globe or three-dimensional structure of this below diagram is a small replica of the existing one, so that we can understand about the particular diagram, particular object. So easy to understand and at the same time easy to design. So it's a synonyms or replica, we can say copy or representation, dummy, imitation, double, duplicate. Okay, these are the synonyms of the model, and at the same time a thing is used example to follow the imitate. So there are different definitions for the model. This is another definition for model. So Abdul Kalam is a role model for us. So he set up some examples to follow him. At the same time, male models, female models. So they set some example how we can look like. So these are some prototype, stereotype, archetype. So style. So these different kinds of models are there. So at the same time, that another definition is it may be a graphical one, graphical model, mathematical model, physical model, and a verbal representation of models, simplified version of concept, phenomenon, and relationships, structure, system. So it can be anything. So when it comes to the bioprocess, first of all, why should we go for developing the model for bioprocess? Because the bioprocess is very complex in nature. See, it involves the microbial cells and media, and there are many other the physical parameters which influence the rate of production of the product. So that since it is very complex, it is always better to have some mathematical model in order to control the reactor, in order to predict the yield and other yield and product formation and enzyme activity. So whatever the objective it may be, so we can go for the prediction once we have a mathematical model. So here the globe is there. Globe is simple model, physical model, which exactly replicates the Earth. So the main use of this globe is we can identify the regions by sitting at one place. The entire globe we can identify the places easily. We can understand the process whenever you have a model. At the same time, some mathematical models are also there. Simple mathematical model here I have given as a Malthus model, that is Rx is equal to mu into x x1. So here the x1 is nothing but is the biomass concentration. Rx is nothing but rate of the biomass generation. It is a very simple mathematical model which gives the relationship between the dependent variables and independent variables in the process. At the same time, there is another neural network model which exactly replicates how our neurons are working. So based upon that, we can develop a model, neural network model, to increase the accuracy of the predictions, and to control the process we can use the neural network, we can optimize the process. So this is how the models can be used in the bioprocess. At the same time, it is a representation of a system, because it's the bioprocess is a system in which there are many other variables which are changing continuously. There's a lot of non-linearity is there, so we need to investigate each and everything, and so that we can maximize our objective. So it's a representation of a system that allows the for investigation for the properties of the system, in some cases prediction of the future. Sometimes after 1 hour, if you want to predict the biomass concentration, what would be the biomass concentration after 1 hour, that we can predict whenever you have a model. Is easily we can go for predictions. So this is another important use of the having a model. And the main use of this models in the bioprocess is we can use these models for understanding the process and to design the process and optimize the process. Not only optimization, we can also control the bioprocess. Once we have a model, easily we can go for controlling. So this is a simple diagram for the bioreactor in which the process is carrying out, bioprocess is carrying out. And here, if you look at the media, there are many components in that. First one is a microbial cell, and the media, and the RPM is another important physical parameter, pH, temperature, substrate concentration, and dissolved oxygen concentrations. There are many parameters which are changing continuously with respect to time. So those things we need to control in order to increase the yield of the product. So if you see the internal parts of this process, so the airflow, and there are some sensors which need to be which we need to use in order to measure the changes which are taking place in the reactor continuously, in order to monitor, in order to control the reactor. So once you, without having the sensors, so we are unable to measure the changes which are taking place in the reactor. So it's always better to have a sensors in order to read the values accurately. So whenever you have a accurate values, then we can observe the values and easily we can control the process. So this is how, this is a typical diagram of the bioreactor. And there are various methodologies to develop a models. So in that, the first one is the empirical approach. It's a old, it's a very old process, a very old method. And it's just measuring the productivity for all combinations of the reactor operating conditions and make correlations. So best example is, suppose if I want to produce amylase production, there are many physical variables which are controlling the activity of the amylase. So we have to find out the variables which are affecting the activity of the amylase. So those are, and at the same time operating conditions also I need to monitor. See, at different variables, at different operating conditions, I need to find out the enzyme activity, and I should finally, I should come to conclusion that at what values the yield is maximum. So the advantage of this process is little throughput and little knowledge is necessary. No need to have a knowledge on this, complete knowledge on this. And the main disadvantage is there are many experiments we need to do before you go for conclusion. So that is the main disadvantage. We need to do literally more than 100 experiments in order to get the optimized operating conditions. Then another approach is a modeling approach. In this, we need to establish a model, and we need to design the experiments first. Before you go for the laboratory, first, always it is better to do the design of the experiments. In general, in the old method, generally what they do is one time one fact at a time method they do. In one fact at a time method, they take all the parameters, and each and every parameter they check by keeping other variables as constant, which allows the more number of experiments we need to do. In order to reduce the number of experiments, always we have to go for, we need to design the experiments before you enter into the laboratory. So, and we need to compare the model behavior with the experimental measures. We need to prepare a model, we need to develop a model from that experiments. And once you develop a model, so we have to simulate the model, and we need to get the data from that, and we need to compare the model values and experimental values. If any deviations are there between the experimental value and the predicted value from the model, then we need to modify the model, or otherwise we need to conduct the experiments once again. We can say that that model is not valid in order to predict the process. And second one, we need, third one is the use of model for rational design and control and optimization. We can also use the developed model in order to design and control and optimization of a process. The main advantage of this modeling approach is very few experiments are required, and the greater understanding is obtained. We should understand the complete process, then only we can do this. And the main disadvantage is some strong thinking is required for this. So that is the main disadvantage. And this is another, this is a model, statistical model. In this statistical model, already I told you, this is related to the design of experiments. In the statistical model, some regression model can be developed. Some example I have given here, there are dependent variables and independent variables. These are dependent variables are the, our objectives generally. These are the objectives. We need to fix the objective before you do any kind of process. The first main objective is, here I have given enzyme activity. Some examples I have given here. Enzyme activity, product yield, and if any degradation studies you are doing, that then percentage of degradation. Like some, these are the final objectives which are depending on some independent variables. And independent variables includes time, temperature, pH, RPM, dissolved oxygen, limiting substrate concentration, product concentration, inhibitor concentrations. Because the limiting substrate concentration is very, very important. Whenever you go for the doing some experiments, sometimes there is a the substrate limitation will be there. Sometimes it may inhibit the growth of the microorganisms. It may inhibit the product formation. So that we need to check. And the product concentration by increase, so sometimes product inhibition also may be there. So that also we need to check. So with these independent variables and dependent variables, and we have to do that experiments, and we can develop the statistical model, that the regression model we can develop. Here I can show you one example. This is one model, mathematical model. It is nothing but it is a mathematical expression which gives the relationship between the variables. Here the variables are A, B, C, D, E. These are the variables. And our objective is, the dependent variable is enzyme activity. Enzyme activity depends upon A, B, C, D, E. So A, B, C, D, E are independent variables. And these are, it may be a temperature, it may be a pH, it may be RPM, it may be a dissolved oxygen. And sometimes yield, suppose your objective is yield of a product. Then it also proportional to the A, B, C, D. These are the other factors, process parameters, which influence the yield and enzyme activity. This is a very simple way and more realistic model through which we can optimize the process, and we can also control the process. And then what are general aspects of modeling approach? This is another approach. It's a mass balance models. We can also develop mass balance models. It is an essential stage in the development for any kind of model. And we need to formulate the mass and energy balance equations. If you look at the diagram, the feed is entering with some initial biomass concentration and substrate concentration with flow rate, volumetric flow rate F naught. And also it leaves with concentration S1 and X1 and with the flow rate of F1. This is a continuous steady state reactor. We can say that it is a chemostat. If you look at this, we can develop models. These are differential equations. The rate of change of substrate concentration and biomass concentration, how these are changing, is based upon the law of conservation of mass. Once you know how much biomass is entering, how much biomass is leaving, how much biomass is accumulating in the reactor. But as here, since it is a continuous reactor, there is no accumulation. So F naught and S naught is the amount of substrate which is coming to the reactor. And F1 and S1, that gives the amount of substrate which is leaving from the reactor. And RS, that gives the rate of substrate utilization. So we have to multiply the volume in order to get the mass per unit time units. So this is D into V S1 by DT, that is the accumulation part. So generally in the chemostat, the accumulation part will be zero. So this is another kind of the methodology to get a model. But here, one thing we need to remember, once you develop this mass balance model, in this, some rate expressions are there. Rate of substrate utilization, rate of biomass generation, rate of product formation. So these rates we need to replace immediately. So then how do you replace? So generally the rate of substrate utilization, rate of biomass formation, we have some standard equations for them. For rate of biomass generation, particularly for exponential growth, so Rx is nothing but it is a according to the Malthus equation is a mu into x. So we have to replace that rate expressions, and the rate of substrate utilization also we need to replace. Rs we need to replace, and we have to write the equation by keeping Rx divided by y, yield coefficient we need to introduce. And it is required to add the appropriate kinetic equations. Once you formulate the equations, mass balance equations, we need to replace those rates by keeping some kinetic equations for rate of cell growth, substrate utilization. As I told you, Rx, we need to replace the rate of biomass generation, we need to replace with mu into X1. And the mu is nothing but Monod's equation. Mu is equal to mu max into S1 divided by Ks plus S1, where Ks is the Monod's constant, and mu max is the maximum specific growth rate. And at the same time, RS also we need to replace, rate of substrate utilization also we need to replace with the help of yield coefficient and rate of biomass generation. And one more important thing is, then how do you get mu max values and Ks value? Mu max is the specific growth rate and Ks is the Monod's constant. Then how to evaluate the Monod's parameters? So for that, we need to conduct the experiment with various subset concentrations. So we need to carry out the experiment. We need to find out the biomass, how the biomass concentration at various concentrations. We need to find out the substrate concentrations at various substrate concentrations. Time versus biomass concentration data we need to get. Once we get the data, the time versus biomass concentration, we need to plot them. In particular exponential data, we need to take and we need to plot them so that each and every subset concentration, specific growth rate value we can determine. Once you determine the specific growth rate value at various subset concentrations, how the specific growth rate value is changing, that data can be generated. Once you generate the data, we can find out the Monod's parameters. Then the combination, once you combine these equations, relationships, then we have to solve these models. So I'm going to show you how to solve them. These are the simultaneous differential equations which are depending on each other, so which we need to solve. So I'm going to show you how to solve them in order to simulate, some software I'm using here, Berkeley Modano software I'm going to use. And this is very, very simple model which I am showing here. It's very, very easy to determine the numerical values for important process parameters like Monod's parameters, very easy. So the Monod's kinetics we can determine, the Ks value, mu value we can determine, yield coefficients also we can determine from the experiments, and maintenance coefficients also we can determine. Whereas these are constant values. We have to determine. Once we have this is the extra information which is required in order to solve them, but particularly with respect to the above the differential equations, these are not required because we are not using any mass transfer equations here. So along with the mass transfer, sometimes we need to use the mass transfer rate and the respiratory coefficient, this and carbon dioxide production rates and oxygen uptake rate, carbon dioxide production rate. These values also we need to determine whenever you want to find these values, we need to conduct the experiment. Particularly for complex fermentations involving the product formation, specific for product formation rate, we call it as QP, is we have to correlate as a complex function of fermentation conditions, because the above equation, we are not dealing with stirrer speed, air flow rate, pH, dissolved oxygen. These values we are not including in the law of conservation of mass equation. So if you want to include them, we need to correlate the equations. And in other cases, simple kinetic models can be used to describe the functional dependence of productivity of the cell density and cell growth rate. And a more detailed structured kinetic, because it is unstructured model we are discussing. In if you want to discuss about the structured kinetic model, which is more complex in nature, it may be required to give an adequate description of the process, since the cell composition is not constant. Cell to cell heterogeneity will be there. One cell in the fermentation process, one cell composition may be different with another cell composition. Cell activity is entirely different from one cell to another cell. Cell age also matters. One cell age is entirely different with another cell, because one daughter cell may be there, one mother cell may be there. So like lot of generations will be there. So a lot of generation gap is there. There is a chance of mutations. So we are not considering anything about that. Only we consider that uniform composition. So we are taking an unstructured model we have described earlier. But if you want to describe the structured kinetic model, which is very, very complex in nature, so the greater complexity of the model, however, the greater is then difficulty in identifying the numerical values. So in order to find out the numerical values is very, very difficult. So that is why always we go for unstructured model, so because it is very easy to solve. Then the final conclusions about the model. The basic purpose of using these models is to analyze the experimental data. So you analyze the experimental data and use to characterize the process by assigning the numerical values to important process variables. And at the same time, the model can also can be used to solve the appropriate numerical data values, particularly for the predictions. So for future predictions, how much yield we are going to get, how much activity we are going to get, how much biomass concentration we are going to get after a few hours, that can be predicted very easily once we have a model. The getting the data from the model is actually is known as simulation. In this bioprocess, once we have a model, then we have to get the data. We have to generate the data with the help of some simulation tools. So otherwise, we need to write a program, this process parameter values, whether it is correct or not, then we need to check the simulated values and experimental values. Both must coincide with each other. Then only we can model is valid. See, for the simulated values and the experimental values both are differ with each other, then we cannot consider that model as correct. So this leads to the use of model process optimization and their use in advanced control strategies in order to control the and another one is the this particular modeling process. It improves the understanding. We can understand the process very easily, and we can also go for the predictions. We can control the process. We can design the process. And the first one is there are different approaches for the modeling and simulation. For any kind of model, first we have to formulate the mathematical model, and then we have to consider the complex cause and effect sequences of the process, because the cause and effect is very, very important, particularly in order to get the statistical model. Because in the statistical model, the design expert, generally what we do, we have to take the physical process parameters and chemical parameters, how these parameters influence your objective, that we are going to check. So what is the cause, what is the effect, that we are going to check in developing the model, particularly in statistical model development. So then once we compare the model predictions with the actual behavior, usually leads to increased understanding. We can understand better way once you compare these model values and the experimental values. So I'm going to show you that simulation part. This is the same models help in experimental design and all. So already I discussed. At the same time, sensitivity tests of the model also we need to do in order to understand which parameters will influence more on your objective. So that we need to conduct. For that, sensitivity test also we need to do. So for that, we have to write a program. This is also same models may be used for predictively for designing and control. And the mathematical models are nothing but the mathematical expressions which gives the relationship between the variables. Variables is nothing but dependent variables and independent variable, and can also be used for the design of relatively sophisticated control algorithms. The model itself can often become the integral part of the control algorithm. So we need to formulate the model, then we need to integrate in order to control the process. So both mathematical and knowledge based models can be used to designing optimization of new any process, any bioprocess. And at the same time, these models can be used for the training and education. I will show you how these models can be used for training and education, how we can educate the people with the help of the simulation tools. So many important aspects of bioreactor operation can be simulated by use of very simple models. So I'm going to show you one simple model, and I will show you that simulation part. Before I go for another thing, I will show you one simulation part. This is one reactor. This is one batch reactor. If you consider starting from an inoculum x at time t is equal to 0, initial biomass concentration is x, and initial quantity of limiting substrate s at time t T is equal to 0. So initially the biomass concentration is X and substrate concentration is S. And how these substrate concentration and biomass concentrations are changing with respect to time. That is the ultimate aim. So we have to find how these values are changing with respect to time. So for that, we need to develop a mass balance model, substrate balance and biomass balance and product balance. So substrate balance is V into dS1 by dt is equal to RS into V, because there is no, since there is no input and output here in the batch fermenter. So there is no input and output here. So only the rate of consumption of biomass, substrate and accumulation part. Here rate of generation of biomass, and this is accumulation, and the rate of generation of the product here, and the rate of generation of the accumulation of the product here. And there is a simple Berkeley-Madonna program. We can see here, this is Ranjakutta method we are using here. because it is a differential expression, here it is a dS by dt. How the substrate concentration is changing with respect to time? How biomass concentration is changing with respect to time? How water concentration is changing with respect to time? So these values are changing with respect to time. So the starting time and stop time we need to give. So 0 to 10 or 0 to 100. So 0 to 10 hours, 100 hours. No, like we can give the time. Differential time, this is incremental time. 0.0 to R1, 10, 1 also we can give. It's always better to give small number. So in order to generate the more data. And UM is nothing but is a specific growth rate value. Mu max, I have written as UM, is 0.3. This value, we have to get it from the experiments. Mu max value and KS value, these two values, and yield coefficient, Y, X by S. X by Y, X by S is nothing but the yield coefficient, amount of biomass produced per unit amount of the substrate concentration. And at the same time, since it is a differential equation, we need to give some initial values. We need to assign some initial values for these X, S and P. And once we assign the initial values, then these differential equations we need to write down. It's a very, very simple way to write these equations. X dash dx by dt, we can write as x dash is equal to rx. Ds by dt, we can write it as s dash, that is rs. Dp by dt, we can write it as rp, that is the. Then we have to write what is rx, rs and rp. Rx is nothing but mu into x. This is according to the Malthus equation. This is the rate of substrate utilization. This is rate of product formation. And this is the mu, the specific growth rate value, Monod's equation. Mu is equal to mu max into S divided by Ks plus S. So once you have this, the program, then once you simulate this program, I will show you the simulation part. This is the Berkeley-Madonna software. Actually, here we need to write a program here. I have written small program for this. The Ranjakutta method, I'm using here. And the stop time, also this time we can change. And the differential time, mu max, Ks value, Y value. These three values, we have to get it from the experiment. And initially, we need to give the initial values, initial biomass, initial substrate. Product concentration initially it is zero, so that p value is zero. And these three differential equations we have to write here. These are the three differential equations. The models are mass balance models we need to write down. And we need to write the rate expressions rx, rs, rp. These are the rate equations, kinetic equations we need to write. And we need to write what is that mu. So once you complete the program in the Berkeley-Madonna, so it's very, very easy to write. There is no syntax here, only except this x dash and s dash and p dash. We need to give the semicolon here. So other than that, no need to give any semicolon or a colon here. So very easy to write this program. So once you run this program, then we can observe how this s value, this value that legend, if you keep it, this is a black colored line. This line, it will indicate the biomass concentration. The red color line, it indicates the substrate concentration. How these values, the substrate concentration is changing with respect to how it is decreasing. Because as the population increases, the substrate concentration decreases because the more utilization is there. Since it is a batch reactor, there is no supply of the substrate further. So the whatever the substrate which is present here, slowly it is coming down. The concentration is coming down as the population increases. So if you want to see that the product, the how the product concentration, the P is the indicates the product concentration, the product, how the product concentration changing with respect. This is one metabolite. So it's a general metabolite. So it's a, it is associated, it's a growth associated product. So how this concentration is changing with respect to time. So these X, S, P, these all three values we can get, we can understand the process. And at the same time, if you want to see the data, how these values are changing with respect to time, there is a table here. So with respect to time, 0.02, because the differential time I have given 0.02. So it is taking from 0 to 10 with an increment 0.02. And X1 data, S data, and P data, these three differential equations it is solving. And it is generating data how these values are changing with respect to time. So from this, we can understand how we can predict after 10 minutes or after the 1 minute. So what could be the concentration of the biomass biomass and the substrate concentration and product concentration? We can predict what exactly happened after a few minutes or few hours. This is the best use of the simulation of the differential equations. So here, first we need to develop the mass balance models, and then we need to write the simple program in this Berkeley Moderna, and we need to run the program. And at the same time, we have another important use. Suppose if you want to check by changing the specific growth rate value and or otherwise the maximum specific growth rate value or KS value or semi any other initial value, if you want to change how these other values are affecting. So for that, we can go for the batch runs. In that batch run, some parameter we need to take. Suppose KS value. KS value, initially I have given some value here. So KS value is around the 0.1 I have given. Suppose instead of 0.1, suppose if the value is 0.2. So how it is going to change? So 0.1 to 0.5, if I want to check. For how many values I want to check, that also I can check. For 5 values or 6 values, so I can do that batch run, how the biomass concentration and the substrate concentrations are changing with respect to the KS value. So this kind of experiments also we can do with the batch runs. This is how the simulation is very, very helpful to understand the process, to understand by changing other values, how other the depending value, dependent values are changing. So these kind of batch studies also we can do. This is the main use of the simulation, particularly in the bioprocess. And then what is the general procedure in order to develop a model? So there is a systematic way to develop a models, this kind of models. In the first stage, first of all, we should fix our objective. What exactly is your objective? Your objective may be sometimes it is a phenol degradation or nitrophenol degradation, some toxic concentration degradation, some degradation studies we'll do. Otherwise, some production studies, some enzyme production, some studies we can do. So we have to fix some objective in the process. So if you fix some objective in the bioprocess, so in order to maximize that value, sometimes we need to minimize. Okay, the optimize is nothing but maximization or minimization process. So some variables we need to maximize, some variables we need to minimize. Sometimes we need to fix the two more than one objectives. So then we can say that is a multi-objective optimization. So first of all, we have to fix the objective. So in order to reach our objective, then what exactly we need to do? So our goals and objectives must be clear before you go for modeling, any kind of modeling. So in general, I'm taking one objective. Let us take some enzyme production. enzyme activity, increase of enzyme activity, that is main objective. So in order to increase that objective, so what parameters are influencing the enzyme activity or enzyme yield, that we need to identify first. So first of all, we have to search for the variables which are affecting that particular objective. So once you identify the objectives, then we have to find out the variables which controls that, and then the second stage, we have to formulate the mathematical. So the available theory must, we have the theory, that is a law of conservation of theory. According to that, we can also formulate the mathematical terms. And another important point is most bioreactor operations involve quite large number of variables, that is like cell substrate, product concentration. So we can operate the reactor at various operation, like batch operation, fed batch. That we need to fix. What are the variables? How you are going to operate? And what is your objective? So these must be clear. So for the above reason, these reasons, the mathematical relationship we can develop with the help of the experimentation. And once you develop the model, then we need to incorporate the kinetic equations in that mathematical equation so that it becomes complex. So then we need to solve them by using some numerical methods like Runge-Kutta method here. Okay. And the next one is, this I think already covered. The next important model is the neural network model. We can also call it as a black box model. First of all, why should we go for the neural network model? Because already we have mass balance model and regression models we have. These are the very good models which are very nearer to the reality. Then what is the need of going for neural network model? Because whenever earlier we are discussing about the predictions. So any kind of model, the accuracy of the model prediction is very, very important. Your model is accurate, that based upon the accuracy of the prediction. So the neural network model that gives the best accuracy of the predictions, if you compare with any statistical model or any other mass balance model. So it is working on how our neurons are working. So if you see the examples, suppose if you are driving a car, if something is coming in front of you, suddenly we apply a brake. Nobody will instruct us to apply a brake. So generally we apply immediately. How your thinking process in that particular time? What exactly is happening in our body? Suppose in that particular situation, for any kind of observations, any kind of things, we need to take the data first. We need to observe the data first. So particularly in the human body, your best sensor, we have some important sensors. The best sensor in our body is your eye. Eye will detect the changes which are taking place nearby. So immediately your eye will take the snaps or photos or videos. It will send a signal to your brain, central nervous system. Immediately that central nervous system will send a signal to the concerned body part, either hand or leg, what exactly you need to do. It will give some set of instructions. Immediately we can control the process. How these neurons are able to control human body, how our neurons are able to remember the patterns. Suppose if you are looking at some one face, even after 10 years or 20 years, we can able to recollect the particular image. So meanwhile, we can come across so many faces, so many millions or trillions of faces. Even then, we can able to retract the face which we have seen 10 years before. So that kind of capacity we have, particularly our neurons are having, particular pattern recognition, controlling, and how we are able to do all these things. So whenever, suppose if you want to retrieve some book from the library, it takes a lot of time. But if you want to retrieve some information which is stored in our brain, immediately we can retrieve. So the accuracy of the prediction is very high. The control is very, very easy. Easily we can control the things within a fraction of seconds. So why I am telling this? Because in the place of human, if you put some emission in that car, the car, we need to arrange some camera for that. Camera has to take continuous snaps, continuous video. It has to send a signal to the central control. And again, there is a transportation lag, measuring lag, and transportation lag, and response lag. Lot of lag is there. One fraction of second is sufficient to get an accident. But human brain is thinking, no, immediately it is sending signals to the concerned part. So based upon the neurons, how your neurons are working. So can we mimic them in order to control the bioprocess? Because the bioprocess is very, you know, complex in nature. Not only in bioprocess, various applications, they are using the neural networks. The same number of neural network can be used to control the bioprocess also. So can we use them? Because we have a data, cause and effect data, the variables we have, and the objectives we have, the input data and output data we have. Once we have the data, we need to train them. We need to train the neurons, because without training, our neurons cannot remember. Because even if you remember something, whenever you learn alphabets, whenever you are in fifth standard, or first standard, second standard, your teacher used to teach A looks like this, B looks like this. Even now we can remember them. So many times we learned on A letter and B letter. So many times we have written. So that particular pattern is registered in our brain. So that registration is not possible without training. So training should be there. Even in order to drive a car, some training is required. Our brain should understand. So the entire mechanism, so that the mechanism will be stored in our brain. Whenever it is required, it will recollect. So the same kind of neural network can be used to control the bioprocess, to develop a model for the bioprocess, so that the accuracy of the prediction will be high. We can control the process. We can optimize the process with the help of the neural networks. So it is a computational model which replicates the function of biological network, the composed of neurons, and are used to solve complex functions in various applications. And also it consists of synchronous processing elements that are inspired by the biological nerve system. I will show you one network, biological network, how we can associate these neural networks. So if you look at the diagram, the input parameters, some input is required, some, we need to give some input, then only it can process. Output we have to give it. It is a black box model. Some important various parameters here, the time, pH, temperature, starch concentration, inoculum size. This is one experiments we did in order to increase the enzyme activity, amylase enzyme activity. The how much protein we are getting and how much enzyme activity we are getting, these are the two objectives. So with these objectives, by taking various other variables, we checked and we did a lot of experiments. From those experiments, we found that these are the five important variables which are affecting more, particularly for total protein and enzyme activity. So we have the data with time, pH, at various time, various pH, various temperatures, how the protein concentration is changing, how enzyme activity is changing. So we have the data. So with this data, we have to train the neural network so that it can remember the weights can be registered. And once the weights are registered, then easily if you give the new data at various, if you give some other pH which is not there in the data, it can easily, it can predict the enzyme activity and protein. So this is generally we get from the neural network. We got it from the MATLAB. This almost regression coefficient is 1. That means whatever the experimental values which we have, even after prediction from the model, the same values we have. The accuracy of the prediction is 100%. Generally, practically, it is not possible. But here, at least 99.9, 99.8 we can get. Then the last thing is the optimization of the process variables. So how do you optimize the process variables? Once we have the model, that is okay. But then how do you go for optimization? In that, we already discussed about the design of experiments earlier. Here, I'm taking a 3-level, 5-factorial central composite design. There are various methods, various levels. And here, I'm taking only 3-level, 5-factorial design. 5 factors means there are 5 factors, important factors. That is time, and substrate concentration. So there are three levels, three levels minimum, maximum, and I will show you those three levels and three replicates. Replicates are very, very important. With a single experiment, we cannot come to conclude because there may be human error. So that is why always we need to check, we need to run the program, we need to run the experiment at least for three times, minimum three times we need to run. And the responses are objectives, we can say. Enzyme activity and total protein, here I am taking an example. So with this, the process variables which we identified as incubation time, so 12 to 72 hours, because in this between 12 to 72 hours, the enzyme activity is maximum and protein concentration is maximum. In between, some value should be there. So pH 4 to 8, we varied. In between, some optimal values is there. Temperature 25 to 45, starch concentration 5 to 25. That the minimum values and maximum values we need to fix. How do you fix these values? First of all, there are many other variables. Here I am not discussing because after Plackett-Berman design, which is used to screen the variables. After screening, we got these five variables. Before you screen, we have nearly 11 variables. Other variables also we have taken consideration. But after screening, these are the five important variables which are affecting that particular objective. So, and at the same time, the minimum and maximum values we need to take from the one factor at a time experiments. What is the minimum incubation time and what is the maximum incubation time? So these two we need to fix based upon one factor at a time method. And this is a three level I already told you, that is the cold levels. The 12 is nothing but is a minimum value. That 72 is the maximum value. This is a average value. So that is why it is a three level, five factorial design. So this is the, up to this, automatically the table is generated from the software. And at these values, we need to carry out the experiments and we need to observe this. These are the observed values. These are the predicted values from the statistical model. The observed values, these are the predicted values from the statistical model. So the observed value is 90. The predicted value from the model, that is 91.6. And 79.5, 79.4. Somewhere the difference is very, very minimal. And some points, the difference is more. So here 34.9, 33.9, difference is more. So 37.5, 37.1. So it is some places the difference is very minimal, some places it is more. So always it is better to go for neural network model than the statistical model. This is the prediction based upon the statistical model. So these are the after optimization, we can also get three-dimensional plots. There are various variables here, time, pH, with respect to the time, how we, from 12 to 72 hours, how this enzyme activity is changing with respect to time. So this how the pH, by changing the pH value, how the enzyme activity is changing. These are the optimal pH values we can identify here. Those are the optimal values. The three-dimensional plot will give you an idea about how these objective values are changing with the variables. Okay. So with this, I finish my presentation. If you have any queries, you are welcome.
Now it's time to thank Dr. Satish Babu Garu for accepting our invitation and for delivering such an informative session. Sir, you've started the session with questions such as what is a model, types of model, the importance of simulation, modeling and optimization in bioprocesses. For me, it was a thorough learning experience, sir, and I'm sure and hope that it is the same with all the participants. So, thank you for making this evening a thoroughly professional learning experience, sir. Thank you very much.